Well, thank you everyone for coming tonight. We've done this series now for a bit over 2 years, and around, I don't know, 6 months ago, we started taking requests, and one of the requests was for Paul Keres, and we wanted to get to Keres, but we needed to do a couple of things first. We needed to better establish Botvinnik, for example, so that we could better understand what Keres went through. And what he went through was pretty amazing. So if it's your first time here, my name is Lucas Anderson. I'm a teacher by day and a librarian. And Warren is a computer scientist by day, but together we co-present wherein I do the history and the political stuff and the context, and Warren analyzes the chess for you. So we play to our strengths there. So this is the year of Paul Keres, 2016, as declared by FIDE, because it's the 100th anniversary of his birth. He was born in 1916. So last November, FIDE declared that 2016 was going to be the year of Paul Keres. I didn't realize that before this lecture, but it is timely that we cover him, so I'm glad we are in 2016 while we still have time. So as I like to do, I like to start by telling you a little bit about where a person's from and who their family is, that sort of thing, but I have to admit a bit of ignorance here. Most authors that I've read, and I've read a lot of biographies, I've read a lot of autobiographies in these lectures. And for this, I relied, not exclusively, but to a large extent, on Keres's autobiography, his 3-volume autobiography. However, I must tell you that it doesn't say much about Keres's biography, like where he grew up, what his childhood was like, what his family was like. I don't even know, and this sounds bad, I don't even know if Keres ever married. Does anybody know, perchance? There's.
I saw pictures of marriage.
Yeah. Okay. There's no mention of a wife in any of his writings. So, in fact, you see Paul Keres's nicknames there, the Crown Prince of Chess, because he never actually won a championship, and he only had the opportunity to one time. And I encountered another nickname for him that I actually prefer, and it's Paul the Silent, because he's very careful in what he says and he's very careful in what he doesn't say. So Keres was born in 1916 in Narva, which at the time was part of the Russian Empire, but now is part of Estonia, an independent Baltic state. However, Narva is right on the border, actually. That arrow kind of points roughly to it, right on the border between Estonia and the USSR, and that's going to come up again. Now, Keres died June 5th, 1975. Reportedly, he died in Helsinki, Finland. At least that's where he was declared dead. In all likelihood, he actually died on an international flight from Vancouver, Canada, to Helsinki. So sometimes when you look, it says he died in Vancouver, Canada. Sometimes when you look, it says Helsinki, Finland. But that's the reason why. So in his autobiography, Paul doesn't talk about his family very much. He talks about the fact that he learned to play chess by watching his father. When he was 4 or 5 years old, he and his brother would watch their father play with his friends. Paul's brother and Paul would spend a significant amount of time studying chess together. Now, they didn't have access to books. There were no, his small town in Narva, there were no bookstores that sold chess literature. There were no coaches, I don't think. So what Keres would do is he would read the newspaper, and the newspaper would have a column where they'd have positions, and they'd have, sometimes they'd reprint games, and he would compile a kind of a database, if you will, or a notebook full of games. And he collected about 1,000 games, and it's in this way that he learned that there's such a thing as chess notation. He taught himself chess notation. And he and his brother used to take those puzzles from the newspaper and think about them and discuss them for hours on end. And that's one way he got better. Paul was the more devoted of the two, and he quickly became better than both his brother and his father. Now, I mentioned that Keres is from a town in Estonia. I need to establish something about Estonia for those of us who have never been. Estonia is a small country, about 1.3 million people currently. Historically, it would have been lower than that. And Estonia is pretty small. As you can see on the map, it's about the size of Denmark. It's a little bigger than Denmark. It's about twice the size of New Hampshire, if you want to compare it to a U.S. state. So it's not a very big country. It's not a very populous country. It is a country that has a long history of being dominated by foreign powers going back to probably the 10th or 11th century. So it has a long history, and we're going to establish a little bit of that because you need to understand it to understand Keres's backdrop. But understand that he was born in 1916, 2 years before the Bolshevik Revolution. So he was born during World War I. And at the time he was born, Estonia was occupied by the Germans. The Germans didn't leave until, they didn't leave until much later, and they only left because they lost the war. What happened was Russia signed a treaty renouncing their claims to Estonia, and then that was during the German occupation. And so Estonia said, well, we're not part of Russia anymore, so we are our own country, we just happen to be occupied. So they declared independence, and on the left I have their Declaration of Independence. They declared independence on February 23rd, 1918. The Germans occupied the city of Tallinn, which is the capital of Estonia, the very next day. And they remained in possession of Estonia until late 1918. Obviously, you know, the armistice to end World War I was in November of 1918. But even after they lost, even after the Germans lost, they didn't leave until January of 1919. So during that time, Narva was a focal point of the war. It had very important strategical aspects because it's on the coast and because it served as kind of a point of attack or point of defense between Russia and the Germans. So during Keres's childhood, his parents would have been maybe evacuating into shelters, you know, maybe dealing with rationing or other aspects of the war. Maybe, you know, family members of his died. It's we don't really know. But finally, in January of 1920, and I guess I should establish, when the Germans retreated, the Russians said, oh yeah, that treaty we signed, never mind that, and they reinvaded. We're no longer renouncing our claims. They invaded through Narva, and so then Estonia waged a war of independence that would last until through 1919 into 1920, and finally, in February of 1920, they signed a treaty, the Treaty of Tartu, which said that Russia would again renounce its claims to Estonia and Estonia would be an independent nation. So February 1920 is considered their Independence Day for a while. We'll get to the while part in a moment. So obviously it was very difficult for Keres to get much experience playing better players. He quickly realized that in his town of Pärnu there were no real players much better than him, and this is talking about Keres when he's, you know, 14, 15 years old. So what does he do? Well, he turns to the thing that a lot of other chess players have done. He plays a lot of correspondence games. Now, it took him a while to get good at this, but after a couple of years, Keres was conducting 150 correspondence games at a time. So he's playing a lot, and he used it primarily to test openings, to polish his opening theory. And Keres is a very aggressive player, particularly when he's young. He's a very tactical player. So he was using it also to test gambits. He loved gambits, and he played a lot of them, including in some of the games in his later career when he was, you know, more of a professional. But he certainly enjoyed aggressive, dynamic openings, and he tested them a lot in correspondence games. Now, one of the breakout moments for Keres was in 1928. Vladas Mekenas, who was an international master and actually would go on to have a long and storied career in chess, he came to Pärnu to do a simul. And of course, all the best players in Pärnu got together, you know, I don't know, 10, 15, however many of them. But Keres was able to play. His father took him. And Keres took a point off of Mekenas, and this was a pretty big deal. It's kind of like when Capablanca came to play a simul in Moscow, and and Bob Bennett got a draw, right? You know, it was a sign that this was a player to look out for. So Keres started playing in schoolboy championships. So they would take the best, like, scholastic tournaments, essentially, for championships in Estonia. And in 1930, he won in his first tournament. He won again in 1932 and in 1933. He didn't win in 1931 because he didn't participate because of illness. But every year he participated, he was the best scholastic player in Estonia. And this earned him the right to play in the adult tournaments. Understand that in 1933, Keres is 16, 17 years old. So this is a pretty big deal. So he plays in his first adult tournament in, his first Estonian national tournament. In 1935, he plays in the Championship of Estonia, and he actually ties for first and then wins a playoff. So he becomes champion of Estonia in 1935, and he would go on to repeat that feat many, many times. And because he was champion of Estonia, he won the right to represent Estonia on board one in their first Olympiad, which was 1935. Now, if you look, Estonia finished 11th, a respectable 11th, I suppose, given that it's such a small country. But if you look who he was facing on board one, he was facing Aljekin, Petrov, Grunfeld, Flohr, Tartakower, Stahlberg, Ruben Fine. He was playing some very, very tough players. I think Capablanca represented Cuba on board one as well. And his losses, he finished 12 out of 19. He had four losses to Aljekin, Flohr, Tartakower, and Steiner. So 12 out of 19, he was actually fifth on board one, which means he performed, if you want to think of it that way, above his team. He brought his team up. And fifth for a 19-year-old or something against some of the best players in the world was pretty impressive. So this allowed Keres to kind of make his mark on the international community and start getting tournament invitations. So 1936, 1937, 1938 were very busy years for him in terms of tournaments. And we're going to, when I say we, I mean Warren's going to present four games tonight. And the first game he's going to present is from this period where Keres faced Aljekin at the Margate tournament in 1937. And for that, I will turn it over to Warren.
All right, so if you've seen even a small subset of Paul's games, you'll probably note that he's a pretty aggressive player. You know, when he wins games, it's not, you know, he wins a pawn and then, you know, wins in the end game. You know, this guy was definitely taught from the Romantic school of chess. You know, that he played the King's Gambit a lot with White, by the way. You know, he mentioned they like playing gambits, you know, King's Gambit especially. You know, he's one of the, you know, strongest players in the 20th century, in addition to Spassky, who would play the King's Gambit against some tough competition. And, you know, Spassky, if I remember too, actually beat Fischer with it. But anyway, let's see how Paul crushes Aljekin. And Aljekin himself was known for being a very sharp, dynamic player as well. So it's really interesting to see how he does that to Aljekin. So first off, we get this kind of unusual opening. It's a delayed Steinitz. Now, it's not really terribly accurate, and you'll see why. Now, if Aljekin wanted to play the opening he did, really he should have tried what's called the Smyslov variation, which is simply g6 immediately here. Now, the benefit of playing g6 is that it doesn't allow White to get the play he does in the game. And to show you why, if White tries playing as he does in the game with c4 here, then after bishop g7, White is unable to play d4. And even here, this is fine for White. White can play moves like d3, and you get a similar position. But essentially, Black will have won a full tempo because White will have to play d4 in two moves. You know, not that White is losing or anything, but a tempo is important in the opening. And we'll see with the way Aljekin plays it that this ends up being a problem. So c4, this might look counterintuitive in the Ruy Lopez, because usually in the Ruy Lopez, you play for c3 and d4, But in the Steinitz, black is actually well prepared for that. So if white goes for the c3 move here, black can play bishop d7, and you know, white's of course fine here, but black usually has a very solid position. He'll play either, there's a couple different plans. You can play knight e7 to g6, or you can play bishop e7, knight f6, and castle. And in either case, it's kind of a long, drawn-out battle. In general, you don't see the Steinitz much because it's kind of passive. You know, the last time you really see it at the world stage would be when in the world championship matches between Short and Kasparov. That was really the last time you saw it at the highest level. But nonetheless, it's still possible. But the c4 move is the most testing. And the reason is white gets a lot of space. And now we see this d4 move. Now you can play for g6 because now if you play your bishop on e7, you're going to be really cramped. White has this large pawn center, and it's really not something you want to suggest here. So now d4, and in one move, as I noted. And now knight f6 is okay. Keres mentions that he thinks this is a mistake already. Not really quite that bad, as it turns out. But he does say that black should probably take. And then here he mentions that that black should play knight f6. Did I get the line right? Oh, I'm sorry. It's not after bishop b3, it's after this position here. He mentions that he thinks black should have played taking on d4 right away instead of playing bishop g7, with the point being that he can play knight f6, or he mentions after knight e7 that c5 is strong, but he didn't really appreciate that after knight f6, c5 is still really strong. Now the point of c5 is to create a weakness on d6, and then unfortunately black can't really avoid it. D5 loses a pawn since white can take it, and take on c5 is obviously ridiculous. You know, tripled c pawns is never going to end well. And besides that, if black tries to defend d6, it doesn't work out well either. White can take it, play bishop f4, and again this is not a good position for black. You know, take on b2, rook c1, and d6 is going to fall. So in any event, that probably wasn't such a great line. So I think what Aljakin played here with bishop g7 was actually fine. You know, I noticed in some of Keres's annotations, and Kasparov in his book copies them too, that he's really optimistic. I think he kind of suffers from, some kind of bias where you win a game and you think that all these things your opponent did were wrong. Not really the case. He was a bit optimistic, I think. But anyway, so now he takes on e5, and his point is that bishop c5 stops black from castling. And this is a problem, although in the game, Aljakin played knight h5, which was kind of panicky. It turns out bishop f8 would actually be reasonable for black. It may look kind of strange, but if white takes, then king takes, and black can castle by hand in just one more move. Now, I'll just remind you that white can't win a pawn because in traditional Steinitz style, the counterattack on e4, you know, means that e5 isn't hanging. So black would probably be okay here. He is slightly worse, but it's perfectly playable. So Aljakin kind of panics with this knight h5 move. And at this point, Keres plays knight d5, which is certainly good. Although, when you analyze with the computer, it just wants white to play this queen b3 move, which is really interesting, actually. This is not a move I would ever consider as a human. But the reason is really simple. White just wants to castle queenside as soon as possible and get a rook on the d-file. And it turns out that's actually really annoying for black. Queen b3 right away here would just be really strong. You know, after say if black were to play like knight f4, castles queenside, and white has a lot of pressure. It's not easy to find a good move for black. But knight d5 is a good move as well. Now of course Aljakin didn't want to tolerate this knight. Now takes. And Keres now played this really interesting pawn sacrifice with e5. Again, though, it probably wasn't best. He mentioned in his own annotations that castling was the best move here, but again, the computer says queen b3 is the best move, followed again by castling queenside. It's a really strong idea. I mean, not only does the rook come to the d-file, but b7's under threat. So black doesn't really have a lot of time to deal with this. But in the game, he played e5, which was probably optimistic. Al-Yekin didn't take the pawn, but if he had, I think he would have been okay. Now, the point was queen e2, and it's awkward for black to stop this pin on the e-file, so he has to play f6. And now castles queenside. But Keres, for some reason, only analyzes c6, but the heartless computer says black can just take, and that this is going to be hard for white to win. You know, white only has about maybe a half pawn advantage here, and you know, I can kind of see that. I'm not really sure how white's going to make much of this position. But Al-Yekin did not take the pawn and played this g5 move. But this turns out to be too slow, because now queen d5 and bishop f8. Bishop f8 now, however, is kind of late. G4 might look tempting, but that doesn't work out either, since white can play e6. Of course, this is a problem for black, because f takes e6 would lose to an embarrassing checkmate. And if you play bishop takes, then white can take on c6 and cause black a lot of problems this way. Now knight d4, and white is just clearly better now. So unfortunately, black doesn't have time to execute his g4 move, so he has to play bishop f8. But now he's just in a really passive position. And now bishop takes c6. This is a nice, precise move here. The point being that black was wanting to castle queenside, and now if he plays bishop takes as he does, he still can't castle queenside. But b takes wouldn't be any better because of queen a5. And now not only is the queenside pawn structure wrecked, but c7's weak, and we have these other weaknesses on c6 and a6. So he took with the bishop, but after queen d3, there's a threat to this h7 pawn, and black really doesn't have a good move here. White exploits the fact that the knight can't be taken because of mate on d7. And after black castles, he just goes back. So now white's up a clear pawn, and black also has a couple pawn weaknesses remaining. And although the game could have still gone on longer, there could still be some fight here. Now Al-Yekin just blundered. He played queen b4. So see if you can find the win for white.
Queen takes d7.
I think she had the same idea, right? Yeah. Queen takes d7. Yep. I think Al-Yekin, yeah, he just resigned here. Of course, if rook takes, then rook e8, and it's going to be checkmate, right? Yeah, I imagine beating Al-Yekin in that kind of style must be pretty satisfying. All right, so any questions on this game?
I'd like to make a couple of points from what Warren was saying. First, the annotations that he's referring to are in the book on Keres that we have, or actually it's three volumes. So I want to talk about that first. And I have them all here. And I said that I called him Paul the Silent, and in a sense, that's because this book is, well, each volume was, let's say, almost 200 pages. I'd say about 140 pages of that is chess and annotations. And for example, his annotations on the Al-Yekin game, even though it's so short, are almost 5 pages. And sometimes it's very, very detailed. Keres says in his foreword that he really had to choose how he was going to structure his book. Was he going to include draws and losses, as well as wins? Was he going to go for very brief annotations? Was he going to leave the annotations as they were when he originally did them in the 30s or 40s or 50s? Or was he going to revise them somewhat when he actually submitted these manuscripts for publication in the 60s? And what he decided is, A, he was only going to include wins. B, he was going to annotate extensively as if he were teaching. And C, that he would go back and revise some of the annotations and update them with current theory, but he'd do so in a light fashion. He wouldn't completely change the annotations. So anyway, if you're interested in the books, that's the approach he takes. So after Margate, and after that win, Keres is invited to other tournaments. Because he ties for first at Margate with Reuben Fine. He goes plus 6, minus 0, equals 3. He was 1.5 points ahead of Al Yakin, who is the former world champion at this point and soon to be world champion at this point also, because he's going to beat Uwe in their rematch and retake his title. So he was then invited to the Simmering Tournament in 1937, and it's one of his best tournaments of, well, pre-war for sure, one of his best performances, because he had a very strong field that he was against, you know, Reuben Fine, Capablanca, Reshevsky, Flor, Elskasis, Rogozin, Petrovs. We've heard these names. And Keres just wanted to go in and play good chess. And he ended up winning a clear point ahead of the field. And you see that he had, it looks like, two losses, but other than that, you know, it was wins or draws against the strongest players of that time. Keres, it bears mentioning, is about 22 at this point, so he's the up-and-coming talent. Capablanca at this point is, no offense to Capablanca, but he's going to die in a couple of years. You know, he's in his 40s or 50s at this point, and he is kind of the old guard of the chess world, as is Al Yakin, although Al Yakin still has a number of years of fight ahead of him. So after Simmering, he was invited to a couple of other tournaments, and I'll go over those in a moment. But I wanted to do something a little different on this particular lecture. I perused the archives of the Estonian government, and I found some films, actually with the help of a chess historian, Mr. Winter, found some films that cover Keres at different points of his career. And so I'm going to intersperse some video clips in this, and I hope that it works out well. The first one that I have for you is from 1938, and no sound. And some blitz. So you can see that even in 1938, he was recognized as a national figure in Estonia, and they were going to great lengths to promote him, to record him, to talk about him on the news, and he became kind of a representative, an ambassador, kind of like an Olympic athlete, if you will, representing his country internationally. Obviously, Keres's greatest pre-war tournament was Avro 1938. I talked about this in the Botvinnik lecture, I talked about it in the Capablanca lecture, I talked about it in the Al Yakin lecture. It's considered by many chess historians as one of the strongest tournaments in the history of chess. Essentially, you had all the top players, including Al Yakin and Capablanca. Remember, usually they didn't play each other in tournaments. If Aljekin was going, Capablanca would refuse to go. If Capablanca was going, Aljekin would refuse to go, etc. But a committee in Holland, in the Netherlands, the OWA committee, it was named after Max OWA, they organized a series of tournaments to try to get a candidate cycle and a champion and a challenge cycle established. Remember, in the time of going back to Lasker, really, the challenger had to distinguish themselves in some way, issue a challenge, secure financial backing, and this is the equivalent of, in today's dollars, of hundreds of thousands of dollars they'd have to secure in financial backing. And then the champion could decide whether or not to accept their challenge. And a lot of times they didn't. They just sat on their championship for a while. So FIDE and the OWA committee worked out a deal that said that whoever won the Avro tournament, or whoever finished second if Aljekin won, would become the challenger for Aljekin. And I told you that in the Botvinnik lecture that Keres won that tournament, tied for first, but then beat Ruben Fine in a playoff. And incidentally, Ruben Fine kind of renounced his claim to challenge Aljekin because he was in the United States and there was already quite a bit of tension between the US and Europe, pre-war tension. And Fine kind of removed himself from contention, saying that he didn't want to compete. So instead, it was Keres who was determined to be the most suitable challenger. And there were extensive negotiations, but they were derailed and a match never came to be for really two reasons. One, the war broke out. And two, Keres was really busy studying math. He was getting a college education, as a lot of people, pretty much everybody at the time did. You remember Aljekin was he had a doctorate and he was a lawyer, and Owa was also had a doctorate. And it was very common, Botvinnik had a doctorate as well. So it was very common for these chess players to get university educations. And so those were really the two factors. I told you also that Botvinnik was the only person who had the distinction of beating both Aljekin and Capablanca, although Keres did quite well. You'll see he had +3 essentially in a lot of draws, didn't lose to anybody, which was impressive. And also he had the head-to-head tiebreak against Ruben Fine. So after this tournament, there are not many tournaments being organized because World War II is soon to erupt. So instead, Keres focuses on his studies, as I've already established. And the Estonian government was kind enough to film him getting his diploma, which is pretty cool. There's him taking his test. So there he gets his diploma. This was in 1940. He did compete in one last pre-war Olympiad, chess Olympiad, and this is in 1939. You may recall that it took place in Argentina, and you may also recall that World War II erupted during this Olympiad. There were a couple of teams that left in protest to get back to England as quickly as possible, or the English team left. That was one of the teams that left. That left as quickly as possible and refused to play the German team. But there were a number of teams that stayed, and of the teams that stayed, Estonia actually finished third. They went from 11th to third. Keres is on board one, and he is the silver medalist on board one behind Capablanca. So he had a very strong performance against, again, the best players of that time period. Many players decided to stay in Argentina, and Keres stayed around a little while. He stayed a month or two to play some tournaments. Kind of waited for things to settle down, see how things were going to shake out. He stayed in Argentina a bit, but some players like Miguel Najdorf stayed the entire war. Stayed and didn't go back until after World War II was over. In fact, the entire German team stayed in Argentina. A little trivia for you. So I'm not going to say that they defected, but they didn't return to Germany, maybe because they were afraid of getting drafted for service, or maybe they didn't agree with the ideology, or maybe a mix of all those things. I don't know, but the entire, all five of them stayed in Argentina. Keres went back to Europe. He didn't immediately go back to Europe, but he did go back in late 1939, and he went because he was invited to participate in a match with Max Owe. The Owe committee is still at work. They're still trying to get a challenger. They're still trying to get a world championship match. And so what they decide is that they will have a match. They'll pay for it. It'll be in a couple different cities in the Netherlands. And the winner of the match should be Al Yakin's challenger. So that is why Keres was, one of the reasons why Keres was anxious to get back to Europe. And for one of the games in that match, the ninth game, in fact, often called Keres's ninth, you know, as an allusion to Beethoven's ninth, I'll turn it over to Warren again for some analysis.
Yeah, and in terms of games we've gone over in these lectures, this game with Owe is definitely one of the coolest, I would say. You know, this game is pretty sweet. But surprisingly, I started off with a calm opening. So it starts off as the Queen's Indian. And Keres plays, at the time, which was the main line with this Bishop B7 move. Later in the 20th century, it became more common for black to play this Bishop A6 idea, just trying to gain time, make white waste some time defending it. But at the time, Bishop B7 was very popular. And now he opted for this Knight E4 move, and you know, surprisingly enough, you might not think this from what happens in the game, but you know, he was trying to play something calm. You know, typically when you're in a match, it's ideal that you draw with black, and then with white, you can try to play for a win, right? So he wasn't trying to make any complications or anything. He's trying to simplify, trade a pair of pieces. You know, if black wants to play for a more complicated game, there's ways to do that. You know, black can play D5 or Knight A6. The game will, you know, stay more complicated if you choose either of those. But he went for this Knight E4 move. Now Knight takes C3. Now he mentions, you know, if black wants to play more for a win, you can try this F5 move to be more aggressive. But again, trading pieces is what he was trying to do. And now is where he starts to play kind of creatively with this D6 move. And you know, he thought that D6 was just not a good move, basically. He, in his annotations, he doesn't speak very highly of it. But as Kasparov points out, you know, after he played this, there are a lot of strong players that took it up. Al Yakin played it. Botvinnik played it. I don't know if Capablanca was alive much longer after this, but I believe he mentioned that Capablanca had played it. So maybe it was previously. So he's kind of a little harsh on himself for this. D6 is definitely perfectly fine. You know, he mentions that black should play Bishop E4 here. The point of this move is to get control over E4 and prevent white from using the queen to influence it. As you'll see, Owe plays, you know, the queen back to C2 so that he can play E4. So Bishop E4 is a pretty standard idea in this Queen's Indian positions, by the way. The point is that if white wants to play e4, he'll have to exchange light-squared bishops, which, as far as black is concerned, that just means another piece trade, another kind of trend towards simplification, equality, right? And then, you know, just by the way, if white wants to play more complicated in this kind of position, you'll often see this strange-looking move, bishop h3, with the point that now when we move the knight back to, say, d2, there's no trade of pieces happening. You know, just you know a little bit about the opening. Okay. So he played this d6 move, and now queen c2 and f5. F5 is really necessary for black to control the e4 square. And now knight e1. As Keres mentions in his annotations, and he's definitely right, d5 is easily the best move for white. This is what white needs to do to try for an advantage. The point is that it's not a pawn sacrifice, because if black takes, white can play knight d4, for example, and we're attacking these e5 and d5 pawns, so there's no sacrifice happening. You know, in fact, the best move for black is just to push past it with e5, but now after e4, white has kind of a slight but lasting advantage, not only because he'll have the e4 square for his knight or bishop later, but this bishop on c8 is rather misplaced. You know, the pawn structure here kind of resembles that of a king's Indian, not what the opening was, right? It started out as a queen's Indian. But if you look at it from that perspective, it's kind of not the best king's Indian, because this bishop is not well placed for a king's Indian defense, right? Normally you want it on c8, where it influences the king side. So he played his 91 move, but white's still fine. White is not by any means worse right now. Now he continues trying to play this kind of speculative style with queen c8. When I say continuing the speculative, you know, d6 and queen c8 are kind of interesting moves. Now, you know, he mentions that he thinks better is just to take and play e5, and he's probably right. This just simplifies, and you know, knight on g2 is kind of awkwardly placed, not necessarily where white would want it, so I think taking on g2 is probably simpler. But he played queen c8, and now e4, knight d7, and d5. Now, d5 is almost certainly bad. It would have been much better for white to take on f5, and it would probably be about equal after this. You know, e takes f5, say takes, and then knight g2, and it's about equal. You know, it's hard to really say that either side is much better here. But in the game with d5, did not work out well, because now black can take on e4, and already white has a problem. He played queen takes e4, but the natural bishop takes e4 doesn't work out well because of knight f6. And he notes that white pretty much has to give up black squared bishop, because now black is threatening e takes d5 and the bishop. So there's not really a whole lot white can do there. That's good. So unfortunately, he takes to the queen, but now black gets an active position after bishop f6. You know, the bishop is really well placed, and soon he's going to get even more activity, as we'll see. So bishop h3, this is another mistake from white. At this point, white should have just played something like bishop e3 and just continuing development. Bishop h3 was really too optimistic. Now rook e8. And white's already running into some problems, because black is threatening to take on d5, actually. It's due to a nice tactic. You know, for example, if white plays knight d3, e takes d5 wins at least a pawn, because if white takes the queen, then rook takes e2, and b7 is defended by our knight. So this works out well for black. You know, for example, takes, and the knight can come right back to c5, and not only is the rook on the 7th, but b2 is weak as well. So white's already having to deal with some threats here. So bishop e3, but now queen d8, simply moving out of the pin. Now bishop takes pawn, and now it's a critical moment. If black simply takes back on c5, white's going to take on e6, and that wouldn't be good for black. Not only would the bishop on b7 be shut out of the game, but white would have won a pawn, right? So black to play. What does black have to play here to avoid being worse? Oh, I'm sorry. I should flip the board, actually.
B takes c5.
If you play B takes c5, it's a pretty similar story to D takes. You know, white will play bishop takes e6, and not only did white win a pawn and the bishop's strong, but your bishop on B7 is also not very good.
E takes D
Mm-hmm. Exactly. So this keeps bishop under threat and just introduces an attack on the queen. Now, bishop e6 is the move he played, but this is probably the last chance white had to get equality, actually. Surprisingly, bishop e3 was probably better. You know, now black has to play d4 to get the piece back, but white can play bishop g2 now. And the unfortunate thing for black here is that white gets to exchange some pieces, right? So takes on g2, knight takes, and knight takes e3, and black is really hardly any better here. Maybe a slight edge after, say, bishop d4, rook e1, bishop takes, and f takes. Black has a slightly better pawn structure, but you know, realistically, probably not going to be able to win this against best play. So this was probably white's last chance, actually, to keep equality, was to play bishop e3, but he went for bishop e6. And this turned out to be definitely a mistake in judgment. So king shuffles over, and now rook d1. Now, white has a bit of a problem here. Bishop doesn't have a whole lot of good squares. You can't go to d4 or e3, because d4 would hang the bishop, and e3 would hang the bishop on e6. And if you play bishop to a3, you're still going to have problems fetching that light squared bishop out. Black could play d4, and bishop c8 is going to come soon to attack that bishop. So rook d1, and white was trying to put some more pressure on d5, but it doesn't work out very well, actually. And here's where Keres makes his first, I would say, mistake in the game, really. D4 was not a good move, and he points out, and you know, Kasparov definitely agrees with him, that bishop d4 was the right move here. You know, d4 simply closed off the dark squared bishop. Now, the bishop was really active on that d4 square. So d4 was definitely not best. But now white made a very poor decision here, playing f4. F4, as you can see, opens up this diagonal. That turns out to be just absolutely lethal. White had to play a move like queen g4 here. And now after, for example, queen e7, rook e1, apparently he was concerned with simplifications, but the problem here is that if black tries to exchange light squared bishops, that it's going to be hard to ever advance that d-pawn. All right. So black really doesn't have much advantage in that case. But in the game, he played f4, which opened up this diagonal to bad effect, and as you might guess, he didn't really spend much time playing d3. So now his bishop can come out actively. And this is a spectacular sacrifice. Now, what he's trying to do here is win the light squared bishop, and white's not going to have much defenders for the king. And amazingly, even though black only has a rook and a bishop for the queen, white's tied up all knots, and he can't really get out of this. You know, it's hard to really suggest what else white should do. Oh, I should mention, rook f2 was pretty much forced. If you play king h1, rook takes e6 is just as bad. You know, now if you try something like f5, black can just play rook e3, followed by rook e8, rook e2, and this is just as painful. And here he makes another good decision, I think. He plays rook e8. If you look at this with the computer, it'll want you to just take on f2, but I think that really helps white solve his problems. I mean, if you think about it, your bishop is really well placed, preventing knight e3. It really takes squares away from the white king. You know, I think rook a8 is a much better move, and Kasparov attaches the next lamb to it. Now white kind of starts to go astray, actually. If white wanted to survive as long as possible, probably had to play a move like rook d2 here. Now white's still in a tough spot, because it's hard to see how he can even move his pieces, since he can't move the knight and can't really move the queen to do anything either. So that's the hard part about this position for white, is it's hard to make it better. But f5 was a bad idea because it opens up this rank for the rook. And now black to play. How do you finish off white here? Bishop b7 looks tempting, but white can play knight d5 and block it out.
Rook takes knight f4.
Mm-hmm. That's right. And now?
Check. That's rook to g8.
Mm-hmm. And unfortunately, the white king has nowhere good it can go. If you go to h1, then bishop b7 checkmates. If you go to f1, rook g1 wins the queen. Oh, we can't go to h3, so that leaves only f3. But now, how does white finish?
Bishop b7.
So bishop b7 would allow white to get away after king e2. And if you play like rook g2, he can play king d3. Mm-hmm. Yeah, now white can't avoid mate, but he would lose the queen if he did so. Now the point being that king e4 loses to what?
E8.
What's that?
Rook e8.
Yeah, rook e8. And then if king d5?
Bishop.
Mm-hmm. And it checkmate, right? Now, white can give up the queen after king g3, bishop f5, but black is up two bishops, right? So that's a decisive material advantage there. So after bishop g4, Ova resigned. So this is a pretty spectacular game. You know, the complications of the middle game are really cool. You know, d3 with the idea of giving up the queen for this powerful battery of two bishops is a great idea. So any questions on this? You know, to me, this game really illustrates the importance of development. I mean, if we look at white's chances to keep equality, it really just had to do with getting the minor pieces out and connecting his rooks. You know, it really just comes down to something simple like that. You know, instead of, if we go back earlier, like even here, you know, when he played bishop b6, you know, he should have just played bishop b3 with the idea of exchanging pieces, just like black had earlier, and just getting an equal game. All right, any questions on this one?
I was watching Peter Spidler play Blitz and broadcast live on the internet. And he called those bishops on adjacent diagonals Horowitz bishops, which was the first time I'd ever heard that. But so that's what they're taught in the Soviet school. That's what they called them. Okay. So the match was 14 games, and you have to understand that Keres, I believe this was his second match ever. He was a strong tournament player, had done very well in tournaments, but Ova was the more experienced, more seasoned match player, for sure. He had played twice against Al Yakin, including beating Al Yakin in match play, and he had a lot more match experience than Keres, but Keres actually won. And you'll note that it was pretty much decided in the 12th game, and then after that he basically just cruise to victory. So I said this was to decide who was going to be the challenger to Al Yakin for the championship. Unfortunately, it wasn't, because the war pretty much prevented that from happening. So I need to give you kind of part two of the sad history of Estonia from the early 20th century. So in August of 1939, about a couple of weeks before Germany invaded Czechoslovakia, the foreign minister of Russia, Molotov and the foreign minister of Germany, von Ribbentrop, they met and they formed a pact. The pact is they basically carved up Europe into two distinct spheres and said, okay, this is my part, this is your part. Got it, good. And it was a non-aggression pact, which obviously Germany then reneged on. But what that meant is that Estonia was assigned to the USSR, or the Soviet Union. It would become the USSR, the Soviet Union. So in September of 1939, right after the war breaks out, the Soviets set up a naval blockade in the Baltic Sea between Estonia and its neighbors like Finland. The point of that was twofold. First, the Soviets hadn't forgotten about Estonia and the other Baltic states, and they wanted them back. Even though they'd signed a couple treaties saying that they'd renounced all rights, they wanted them back. Second, remember from my lecture on Botvinnik, I said that the Soviet Union was trying to expand their territory to serve as a buffer against a German incursion. They were hedging their bets. Yes, we've got that pact, but I don't trust you completely. So they wanted to, remember they invaded Finland, the Winter War, and Molotov cocktails and all that. Well, they also invaded Estonia. And by June of 1940, Estonia was fully occupied by Soviet forces. And the Estonians, under the urging of their political leaders, surrendered without much incident. They were certainly overwhelmed by the military might of the Soviet Union, a country of over 100 million people, and, you know, little Estonia there with their 1 million people roughly. They surrendered. There was a little bit of resistance, but not over much. That was June 1940. They're back under Soviet control. Keres plays in a couple of Soviet championships. Incidentally, during this time, Keres tries to defect to Western Europe and is stopped. June 1941, Narva, Keres, and Estonia as a whole, is liberated, with air quotes, by the Germans. And by August 17th, 1941, the Estonian resistance, who had helped the Germans kick out the Soviets, are forcibly disarmed by the Germans that they had helped, and Germany begins their occupation of Estonia in the summer of 1941. With that came everything else that the Nazis were doing in other parts of Europe, implementation of concentration camps, for example, purging of the Jews and the Gypsies, and anybody who put up any political opposition to the occupation. Essentially what happened is Estonia was told to have an election, and to elect a bunch of people who are friendly to the Nazi regime, or else. And so they did. Keres then, blowing in the political winds, if you will, goes from playing in the Soviet championships to playing in Nazi-sponsored tournaments with Al Yakin. I told you in the Al Yakin lecture that Al Yakin, maybe he was a Nazi sympathizer, maybe he wasn't, but he certainly participated in tournaments sponsored by the Nazi regime, and so did Keres, and I'll get to that. But in 1944, in the fall of 1944, after the Soviets have broken the siege of Leningrad, they reconquer Estonia. And now you've just had a bunch of people who have been forcibly conscripted by the Germans or who have been sent to concentration camps who have been executed for resisting. And now you have the Soviets who say, okay, everybody who collaborated with the Germans, you're gone. So they executed people, or they exiled them to gulags. About 10% of the population of Estonia in this time period was sent, either executed or sent to a gulag, which was almost the same thing, building roads out in Siberia. Incidentally, right before this happened, the intellectuals, they immigrated. You see a boat here on the bottom left. They immigrated as much as they could to surrounding countries because they knew that things were about to get a lot worse. So I mentioned Keres played in a couple of tournaments. He played in Moscow 1940, played in the Soviet Championship, finished fourth, ahead of Botvinnik, for example. Very nice. By 1942, he was participating in tournaments under that were sponsored by the Nazi regime. And incidentally, in the few tournaments that he participated in, he always finished second to Aliyakin. That win that he had in Marburg, I think, was the only win he ever had in his career against Aliyakin. Kind of tells you something about what would have happened if they had actually had a match, perhaps. Now, apparently there's a book about Keres from this time period called The Troubled Years of Paul Keres, The Great Silent One. That's where I came across that nickname. But I couldn't get my hands on it. It was written by an Estonian historian, and maybe it's been translated into English. Maybe it I don't know. There are lots of books written about Keres or written by Keres that have never been translated into English. So our selection of our knowledge about Keres is somewhat limited. Mine was even more limited because they focus just on his autobiographies. And Keres does not talk about this at all. Does not talk about shifting affiliations, playing for the Soviets, then playing for the in Nazi tournaments, then back to the Soviets. Doesn't talk about any of it at all. But we do know from other sources how tough this would have been on him. So I mentioned that a lot of Estonians were detained or even execution, and Keres may have been detained and may have been slated for execution himself. According to Chessbase magazine, quote, when the Red Army liberated Estonia, Soviet officials planned initially to execute Keres. Botvinnik interceded by talking to Stalin. That's what they claim. Keres doesn't talk about it at all. What we do know is that his tournament history is almost non-existent till about 1946. I told you in a couple of lectures that the U.S. played a radio match against the Soviet Union or the USSR in 1946. Keres was not allowed to participate in that match. It wasn't until later in 1946 when he was considered, and this is the word I'm going to use, but it's a word that's been used by a lot of people to describe other people in similar situations, Keres was rehabilitated. In other words, Keres was conditioned, or he was accepting or of the fact that this was the new reality and he was just going to have to deal with it, and he did. And then he was allowed to participate in tournaments again with perhaps some limitations. So the USSR championship in 1947, Botvinnik didn't participate, Keres did, and he won the tournament. He won his first USSR championship. So 1947, he's making his mark. He is strengthening a Soviet team that already has a great deal of depth. And when you look at Bronstein and Smyslov and Botvinnik and even, you know, like Levenfish and Ilya Khan, I mean, almost all these people that are listed here, Andrei Lilienthal, for example, Flohr, probably, you know, eight of the strongest or seven of the strongest 10 players in the world at this time period. And this is after Aliyakin's death and after Capablanca's death, with that caveat. So Keres participated in this tournament, and there's actually some film footage of this, which is kind of interesting, under the picture of Lenin. So it's all smiles and handshakes, but behind the scenes, it probably wasn't. And I wish I could give you Keres' own words for that, but he doesn't talk about it at all. Understand that Keres died in 1975, before the fall of the Soviet Union, and for the rest of his life, and before Estonia regained independence in 1991. understand that Keres was never free to speak. He was never able to speak freely. His livelihood and even his life depended on collusion, and it depended on following the dictates of the Soviet Central Committee and whatever they said in terms of what tournaments to participate in or not participate in, and perhaps even how to conduct those tournaments. Again, some of this is speculation, but in 1948, you'll recall that the six top players in the world were invited to playing each other five times to determine world champion. And Reuben Fine didn't attend, and he wasn't replaced. And you'll note, and this to me is somewhat interesting, remember I told you in the Soviet School of Chess lecture that Botvinnik was favored, but actually some people in the regime favored Smyslov, because Botvinnik had a Jewish connection and his parents were kind of middle class. Smyslov's parents were factory workers, and there are some people in this Central Committee of Government who wanted Botvinnik to be champion and other people who wanted Smyslov to be champion. But if it was one or the other, that's not as big of a deal. They didn't want Keres to be champion. Keres, if Botvinnik is not quite Soviet because he, even though he's born in the Soviet Union, and even though he's a staunch communist, he's got that whole Jewish heritage. Keres was even less of a Soviet because he was from Estonia, who declared their independence, who dared to declare their independence, and who had dared to play in Nazi-sponsored tournaments during World War II. And there are some people who say, there are a lot of people who say, in fact, that Keres was told to throw his games against Botvinnik. And if you look, he lost his first four games against Botvinnik until the outcome was absolutely certain. And then he won his last game. But at that point, it was already certain that Botvinnik was going to win. And so it didn't really matter anymore. There's some people that say that. And if you look, he had a strong record against Smyslov. He had a losing record against Reshevsky. He had a great record against Owa. I mean, dominated Owa. But against Botvinnik, he was dominated, or he allowed himself to be dominated. A lot of people have looked at the games that he played and said it wasn't very good chess. Now, I'm not enough of an expert to have an opinion there. But I will say that considering his previous record against Botvinnik, which was fairly strong, this looks somewhat suspicious. Now, Keres doesn't come out, he doesn't say anything that would indicate that he threw the games. He says things like, quote, "I lost a mostly weakly played game against Botvinnik." And, quote, "I failed to utilize my opportunities to the best advantage, and the scales tipped over in Botvinnik's favor." And he was very praiseworthy of Botvinnik. He said, quote, "The new world champion Botvinnik undoubtedly played the best chess of all, and I am of the opinion that this tournament is qualitatively the best result in his chess career." He sounds a lot like a player, and Keres was a nice guy, really was. People held him in very high esteem, and that's probably what allowed him to survive in the USSR. But to me, it looks like he was being very deferential to Botvinnik. And I wonder how much of that was mandated. We don't have him on record saying, unfortunately. In the 1950 Candidates Tournament, Keres finished fourth. Now, we say Paul II, and that's because in four straight Candidates Tournaments, he finished second. He was not the candidate who went on to challenge the champion, but he was the runner-up. In the 1950 Candidates Tournament, he did fairly well, although he was a bit disappointed with his result. And you see that this really marks and you remember that this is the year that Bronstein essentially drew with Botvinnik and Botvinnik retained his title. But we see the Smyslov placing well again, and so this is, again, the rise of Smyslov. And Keres is not old at this point. This is 1950. He's about 34. He's still in the prime of his chess-playing career, but he doesn't have that same spark, at least in the candidates tournament, that he had before the war. Now, there are going to be exceptions to that, but and there are going to be times where he's fairly dominant, but he'll never reach, again, the pinnacle that he had with Avro, where he won on tiebreaks, and with his match with Owa, where he was essentially guaranteed to be the challenger. It just never quite materialized. He won his second USSR championship in later that same year. Keres often talks about the fact that he starts a tournament kind of slowly. In the first half of the tournament, he's maybe the middle of the leaderboard, but then he summons his reserves and he plays really hard. And he, in this case, he goes 6.5 out of his last seven to edge out the other finishers. And you'll notice again, Botvinnik doesn't participate, but we do have Petrosian creeping up in there as well. And later on, we're going to see some other familiar names like Korchnoi and like Spassky. He follows that up in 1951 by winning it again. And not only did he win it again, but by winning it, he won the zonal and he qualified for the candidates tournament. So he's again going to get to participate in the candidates tournament. Most of the times he participated in the candidates tournament is because he got an automatic seed into the candidates tournament because he was runner-up. But in this case, he was fourth, so he needed to do well in his zonal to get invited to the candidates tournament. And he did. In fact, you'll see that he finished much higher than Botvinnik. And I guess Smyslov didn't participate in this particular tournament. But understand at this point, Botvinnik's backing is wavering somewhat, and Smyslov is kind of the golden boy, or I called him the ginger boy once because he's red hair. But he was the golden boy of Soviet chess at this point, and the force is really rallying behind him. So to give you an idea of how Keres is playing at this point in his career, let's look at game three. This is Keres versus a young Boris Spassky in Gothenburg. This was a, I believe it was a candidates tournament or it was an interzonal, one of the two. And again, turn it over to Warren for that.
So Lucas was talking about, you know, whether, you know, Keres was basically forced to stay silent. And I wanted to refer to something Kasparov notes when OVA was FIDE president in the mid-1970s. This was in 1974. He was already looking for someone to take over as president, and they were at the Olympiad at the time in France, and he was thinking about who to do it, and he saw this crowd of people around Keres, and he was like, wow, okay, this guy is pretty popular, you know, maybe he's someone I should ask. And he asked Keres, you know, if he would think about running, but he did mention, you know, do you think that you could, you know, be impartial and not, you know, favor the Soviet Union as president? And Keres replied that independently, I can only write books. So I guess that answered Ova's question. So I think that says volumes, that reply there. So, all right. And it was a game with Spassky?
Yeah.
All right. So, you know, I even mentioned Spassky earlier as one of the people that played the King's Gambit. So, you know, yet again, you know, here's another game where he has some success against them. I find it kind of interesting, actually, that his Keres had, well, Lucas did mention that he didn't do well against Al Yakin overall, but one of the world champions that Keres did especially well against was Tall. You know, he had a plus record against Tall. I think it was, what, plus 8, minus 4, with some draws mixed in there. And here's a game where he beat Spassky in pretty, you know, great style too. So let's take a look and see how he did it. And interestingly enough, it's again with a quiet opening in the Queen's Indian. I will mention that although, you know, we see the games we're looking at are where he's playing a quiet opening, he did usually tend to play more complicated openings. You know, he had a great game against Botvinnik, for example, in the Richter Rouser and a Sicilian. That was kind of more, you know, standard Keres openings. But, you know, he was a very flexible player, like most strong players are. He didn't just have to play one opening. So the game starts out rather quietly, and already Keres is kind of overly critical, I think. He doesn't really like this knight bd7 move, but he does think it's okay. He thinks that it's better for black to, you know, keep copying white with c5, basically. keep it symmetrical, trying to keep open the possibility of playing knight c6. Because in the game, at this point, he mentions that he thinks c5 is already a mistake. I don't think this is really true, and you know, looking at the database and looking at this with the computer, I think c5 is perfectly fine. But again, I think he was kind of biased by the result of the game here. He thinks that black should play knight e4 followed by f5, which it also seems fine too. You know. But c5, and now queen e2. And queen c7. And here, Spassky does make a mistake. Spassky played rook d8. Instead, he should have taken on d4. And this is important because it gives his pieces extra room, and importantly, the c5 square. And right now, the pawn's on d4, but as you'll see later, it'll be important that black has the ability to use the c5 square, because in the game after rook d8, white now played this d5 move. And this is a problem for black. Note that if the pawns on c5 and e3 had been, you know, exchanged, then black would have the c5 square now for that knight. And that's really important. Now, d5 is a very strong move, by the way, because he played a6, but if black were to take, it doesn't work out very well, because white can take h7.
Oh.
And then take d5. And the black king is very weak here. White has ideas with knight g5, queen h5, and this bishop's also pointed at the king side. It's very, very risky for black. So Spassky didn't go in for this, and he played a6, but it is already hard to offer him a suggestion. And the problem with a6 is that after white takes an e6, e6 is weak, and just the king side in general. So white just has a fantastic position. No decisive attack yet, but it's certainly a great setup for an attack. So again, although, you know, black does have a weakness on e6, it's not a losing position or anything like that yet. So white to play here, how should white try to take advantage of black's weakened kingside? By the way, I'll mention, in the game he played knight h4, and that's certainly fine.
Bishop to g6?
Yeah, Keres mentions that he wishes that he would have put his bishop on g6 here, so as to stop black from playing rook e8 and knight f8, you know, migrating pieces over to the king side. So knight h4 is certainly fine, by the way, but bishop g6, like is mentioned, it would probably have been even stronger. Now bishop d6. And now again, bishop b1. Now, same comment here. Instead of bishop b1, bishop g6, like Keres mentions, would have been much better. It's hard for black to improve his pieces now. Because really, black would not want to play knight b8, moving it away from the king side here. So that would have been a stronger way of conducting the attack. But he played bishop b1, and this allowed Spassky to play rook e8 and then knight f8. And here he kind of slows down the attack again. Now knight g6, you know, just like we were talking about in the Queen's Union earlier, you know, exchanges are pretty much always going to help the defending side. So instead of that, Keres mentions, and he's definitely right, that g4 would have been a much better way of conducting the attack. Avoiding exchanging pieces, and you know, the threat of g5 is really strong. Now, it may look dangerous to move your g-pawn because black can try attacking with like a move like queen c6, but it's really not a problem. White could just play e4, sealing it off, and you know, these kingside pawns are going to give black a big problem over there. So knight g6, but nonetheless, white's still better. You know, this weakened king side just gives black long-term problems. So white has a great position, and here he actually missteps a little bit. He played f takes e5. White is definitely still better after this, but he he should have just recaptured on d5, and black has this problem of e5, and it's hard to solve it with these bishops pointed at the king. You know, for example, if black were to take on g6, then bishop takes would attack the rook on e8, and it's hard to say what black could even play here. If you play rook e7, then white can play bishop f5, followed by bishop e6, and that bishop is just really well posted. You know, black and white could follow up with g4 and g5, pretty easy kingside attack. And if black were to try taking on f4, it doesn't work out well either, since white can take on f6 and then h6, and again white's crashing through on the kingside. So he kind of complicated matters with f takes, but it turns out it's still okay. He missed that black could play bishop takes. And this bishop e6 intermezzo is the point behind Spassky's play. And now black is pretty much okay. White still has a slight edge, but white doesn't have much anymore. Black again exchanges pieces, and now black actually has some queenside counterplay going. And unfortunately for Spassky, he made a huge oversight here. Black would have been pretty much equal if he played a move like knight h7. Just keeping a piece over there, stopping a threat of taking out f6, and black can work on trying to get a passed pawn on the queen side. But instead of that, he made a huge blunder by playing knight 3d7, or 6d7, sorry. So white to play, how does white win? Mm-hmm. Out of nowhere, he's able to sacrifice a queen for a pawn, but the discovery from the bishop on g7 is devastating. Or sorry, b2, and between the knight on d7, the rook in f1, and the two bishops, which is way too much firepower. And I don't think Spassky even bothered responding here. Now, the problem is after knight takes d7, the black king just has no safe haven. Can't go to g6, h7, h8. Can't stay where he is, obviously. And if you play king g8, then knight f6 is just devastating. King f7 loses the queen, and any other move loses the rook with check. That would lose the queen as well. So black is absolutely roasted here. No matter what he does, actually, he's going to lose the queen. So he just resigned after that. So yeah, just kind of a bolt from the blue, but a really nice attacking game from Keres. Not perfectly conducted from either side, but a really nice, you know, example of his play there. So, did you guys have any questions on that one? That really is an important theme where he played that d5 move there. It's a really common idea to push and then rely on that discovery to win a kingside pawn for that center pawn. So these Queen's Union games are a great example of when you can push a pawn as a sacrifice, or what it looks to be, but then utilize some tactics to make use of it or get it back. All right.
I mentioned that Keres was able to kind of secure himself as a member of the Soviet team. He was invited to all the training sessions. He was able actually to compete internationally. You'll remember that a lot of Soviet players were somewhat restricted, like they could travel, but their wives had to stay back or their children had to stay so that, you know, prevent defection. Keres was able to travel to international tournaments fairly freely, and he represented the USSR quite well internationally. In particular, the Olympiads. Now, I'm sorry for the wall of text. Normally, when I do slides, I try to keep the text to a minimum. But I just want to point out all the different Olympiads that he played for the USSR, and how he did. You see that every single time they won team gold, and many of those times he was gold on his board. We just recently had the United States team win the Olympiad in Azerbaijan, and one of the reasons that we won that Olympiad is because we had Wesley So on board 3, one of the top 10 players in the world. that's what the Soviet Union had in Paul Keres. They had one of the top six or seven players in the world playing for them on board three or board four for most of the Olympiads. If you were any other country in the world, you were in deep, deep trouble, right? Now, he did play board one in 1952, and a couple reasons. Botvinnik didn't participate, number one. Number two, that was the USSR's first Olympiad, and nobody on the team had any experience at Olympiads except Paul Keres, because he had represented Estonia in their efforts. So that was why he was, and because he had won also the Soviet Championship in 50 and 51, they put him on board one. And that was pretty tough for him, but he did okay, and they were able to secure team gold. And then from there on, you see his records. After that, he lost one and only one game, and that was in 1964. After 1964, Keres was, I don't want to say relegated, but he was moved to a trainer position. He trained the subsequent Soviet teams and wasn't in the top five anymore, although he did participate in the USSR versus rest of world in, I think, 1970. He was on board 10. So he did continue to represent the USSR internationally somewhat, but not as much after 1964. One of Warren and I's favorite tournaments and favorite books is Zurich 1953. And Keres did quite well in that tournament. You see, he tied for second with Bronstein, finished 2 points back from Smyslov. But remember how I told you in 1948, Keres may have been told to lose to Botvinnik? None other than David Bronstein himself claimed in one of his books published in the late 2000s after his death and after the fall of the Soviet Union, Bronstein claimed that Keres was told to lose to Smyslov in this tournament in a couple of their matches. And you see, he did. He lost to him twice. And the only other loss he had was one loss to Bronstein, and that's it. Everybody else, one loss to Averbakh. That was probably just a earned loss. But it could be that Keres was again told to lose to the chosen one. Remember, by this time, Botvinnik's out of favor. Smyslov is the selected person. And Bronstein, and I have to defer to Bronstein on this, claim that Keres was told to throw his games against Smyslov to help Smyslov conserve his strength. That's the sad part about it. Wasn't told, Smyslov's got to win. He was told Smyslov needs to keep his form up for his other games, so, do something about it. So he did continue to win some other games, or other tournaments. He continued to be a strong tournament player. He won at Hastings in 1957, won in Mar del Plata, 1957 again, ahead of some strong fields. Some current and former world champions were present at both. And as I mentioned, he was a valued member of the Soviet team. Here he is analyzing with Tall. Keres was friends with a couple of the Soviet players. Bronstein was probably his closest friend on the Soviet team. Tall was kind of friends with everybody, and Keres was kind of friends with everybody, so it was natural that they would get along quite well together. But as Warren mentioned, Keres got along with pretty much the entirety of the Soviet team because he did what he was told, and because he was a very friendly, personable, quiet, humble player. I know nowadays it's very common for chess players to be pretty arrogant, the top players. You need only follow Nakamura or Carlsen on Twitter, and you'll see that they do a lot of trash talking. Incidentally, upcoming blitz match between the two on chess.com. And even at this time, there were some very outspoken people in the chess world, Fischer, for example. But Keres was humble and low-key. Part of that was just his personality, but part of that was really the precarity of his position. He was, for all intents and purposes, trapped. Incidentally, during this time, he's still living in Estonia, or, the Republic of Estonia, part of the USSR. One of the last candidates tournaments that Keres participated, or Keres finished second at, rather, tied for second in this case with Geller, was Curacao 1962. And I've said in the Fisher lecture that Fisher accused the Soviets of colluding and arranging draws with one another. And I said in the in other lectures, like the Soviet School of Lecture, that that was probably true. It was definitely true. The Soviet players did agree to early draws or grandmaster draws with one another so that they could save their strength for Fisher. And you see that the top Soviet players all drew against each other. Tal and Korchnoi decided to fight for wins. Sometimes they won, sometimes they lost. But the top three players, Keres was told to draw against Petrosian and Geller, and he did every time. And that was probably to his detriment, because I believe, and some other writers believe, that Keres was actually the stronger player of the strongest player of the three. So if Keres had not been told to draw against Petrosian and Geller, even if he would have picked up one win against Petrosian, that would have been enough to make him the candidate for the championship. And you know that Petrosian won that candidate, that world championship match. Maybe Keres would have in its place. Incidentally, in the three-volume autobiography that I have, Keres never once mentions Bobby Fischer. Again, is that because he didn't take the time to write about it, or because he, you know, didn't want to rock any boats? The world will never know, but he didn't mention Fischer, although he did beat Fischer in a couple of tournaments. In fact, Keres is tied with Beliavsky and with Korchnoi for having the record of most world champions, current or former, or future world champions that he's defeated in match in tournament and match play. Keres has beaten, I think, eight or nine current or previous or future world champions. And again, only Beliavsky and Korchnoi share that distinction. These days, it would be very hard to match that because the world championship, well, I guess perhaps you could if you count like Ponomaryov and Kalifman and all that, but anyway. I mentioned he was able to travel overseas. He participated in the first Piatigorsky Cup in 1963, and he won. Well, he tied with Petrosian, and they drew their matches against one another. So he tied for first. To check his age, Keres is 47 years old at this point. We would now consider that past the prime age. The only players who are close to this age in the top 10 currently are Viswanathan Anand and Veselin Topalov. All the other players in the top 10, their average age is probably about 32, 33, with some of them being very, very young, like with Anish Giri and Fabiano Caruana being 23, 24 years old. So at this point, we would think that Keres is toward the end of his career, but he wasn't. He still had many, many years of good chess ahead of him, but he would never again compete for a shot at the world championship. And he, as I mentioned, after Tel Aviv 1964, he would never represent the Soviet Union or the USSR at the Chess Olympiad, but he would still compete in tournaments and still do quite well. In fact, in a tournament in, this was in Germany in 1972, Hamburg, I think it was, Keres wins. He beats Tigran Petrosian. He finishes ahead of Petrosian, who was at this point the former world champion, Spassky being the current world champion for a little bit longer. And one thing that's really interesting to me about this tournament is second place was Lothar Schmid. Do you remember, I mean, you may know him as a chess player, but do you remember what else he's known for? As an arbiter. Yeah, he was the match arbiter for Fischer versus Spassky, the world championship. Actually, he's the one who had to deal with all the shenanigans there. It was pretty common in this day for strong chess players, grandmasters, to be arbiters for matches. Harry Gollenbeck, the translator and of the Keres autobiography, in fact, was an arbiter at several different tournaments that Keres participated in and matches also. Okay, let's look at our final game of the night. This is from Keres's kind of last shot at becoming a candidate in 1962 against Geller, one of the strongest players in the USSR and one of the few people who had a strong plus record against Fischer, in fact. So again, I'll turn that over to Warren.
So this game against Geller is really impressive because he conducts the attack pretty much perfectly, and really, once he got the advantage, he never let it go, and it's really a great game. So let's check it out. And already, both Keres and Kasparov kind of criticized this knight takes c3 move, saying that c takes d4 is a much, much better idea, giving white the isolated d pawn instead of the hanging pawns on e4 and d4. And it seems like they're both right based on the opening theory and what happens in the game anyway. But in the game, he captured on c3. And Keres and Kasparov also point out that e4 is probably not the best move, actually. It's more precise to start with queen e2 and then play rook d1. And after e4, this would let the bishop be developed along this diagonal towards the king side. So the pawn would have been slightly more accurate, but e4 is still definitely fine. Now the problem for white, of course, is that queen e2 isn't possible anymore since black could win the d4 pawn, right? So that's why queen e2 before playing e4 was a little bit better. Okay, so bishop b2. And black is already kind of in a tough spot. White's already preparing for this d5 advance. In fact, if it were white's move, I think Keres would have played it right away. So black took on d4. Now Keres mentions that, you know, maybe queen c7 would have been better, but Kasparov analyzes it and you know, comes to the conclusion that basically black's still in a tough spot. White can still play this d5 advance. Remember I talked about last game how it's a thematic idea? Yet again, we see the same idea. And yet again, the point is that black can't win this pawn because the king side gets wrecked by this bishop h7 move. You know, black's king, again, is just very, very loose. It's going to be very difficult to defend that position. So he took on d4, which has the advantage of opening up the c-file for the rook, but the problem is that he'll never end up using it for one, and two, this bishop on b2 is now coming to life, right? But now Gellert kind of makes his last mistake by playing bishop b4. A good idea in principle, try to play bishop c3, get rid of that this dangerous pair of bishops pointing towards the king side, and just exchange a pair of pieces. But it turns out that bishop f6 would have been much, much better. Black is still really passively placed, but at least this way, if white were to push d5, he could exchange a pair of bishops. And if white plays e5, it would block this bishop on b2. So this would have made it much harder for Keres to break through. It's just a passive position for black rather than basically a lost one, as you'll see. But bishop b4 allows Keres, again, to play this classic d5 break. And it is really strong here. So black played queen e7. It's really hard to say what he could even do here. Bishop takes d5, loses to queen e5. Because after f6, white could play queen h5, hitting h7. And now if g6, how does white win here after g6?
Queen to h6 and then move knight.
Well, queen h6 is almost certainly good, but there's going to be still some chess to play after maybe rook c7. Now, if knight g5, he could take it since knight on g7 is covered.
Bishop takes g6.
Very nice, yes. Threatening mate in h7 and attacking the bishop on d5. Now, the problem for black is that if he takes, then white wins the piece back with queen h5 check. Right, for example, king g7, rook takes d5. And not only is white up a pawn, but he still has a raging attack against the king, right? In fact, black's in huge trouble because rook g5 is a mate threat. So black is very bad spot there. So the d5 pawn is basically untouchable. So queen e7, and now knight e5. Another very nice centralizing move. And black doesn't really have many good options. He tried to play f6, trying to push it away, but this does not work out very well. Other moves don't work out well either. For example, bishop d6 doesn't work out because of queen h5, threatening h7, g6, and now white's play has a crushing move. See if you can find it.
Knight g4.
Very nice, yes. The problem here is the queen's immune because of knight h6, checkmate. The only way to stop it is to play f6. But now white can play queen h4, attacking f6. And now g5. And now white to play. Yeah, queen takes g5.
Oh, wow.
The point being that if black takes, knight h6 is checkmate. So white has all kinds of strong attacking ideas here, so it's really hard to make a suggestion here. Pretty much everything is going to be really tough position for black. So he played f6, but now queen h5, g6, and now? Unfortunately, knight g4 doesn't work now, since there's the a1 h8 diagonal has been blocked.
Knight takes g6.
But now this sacrifice for the two pawns leaves black's king just too open. The rook maneuvers itself to g3, and this is deadly. Black tries to cover it with bishop d6, but now white can play what? Just blocking the bishop's influence on g3, and there's really no solution to stopping rook g3. Very deadly. Of course, if he plays king h7, or f7, because if king h7, rook h3 is checkmate.
Yes.
So king f7 is forced. And now queen e6. And queen h3 is checkmate. So just a beautiful attack. Anyway, this game really illustrates the power of those two bishops sweeping towards the king. You guys have any questions on this one? All right, I mean, it was essentially a perfect attack. Keres really only made one maybe inaccurate move with e4 early instead of queen e2, but other than that, pretty much a perfect game.
So I mentioned that he had quite a bit of chess left. In 1972, there was a tournament in San Antonio, actually, a little jog down I-10 from us, and Keres finished fifth in that tournament. But when you look at the names of the people who participated, that's not bad. He finished ahead of people like Bent Larsen, Walter Brown, for example. Obviously, that was a little early in Walter Brown's career, and a little early in Karpov's career, too. But he only finished a point out of, you know, a tie for first, which is pretty darn close, actually. In 1974, Keres didn't play, because he was ill, but in 75 he participated in a tournament in Estonia, and there he finished clear first ahead of former world champion Boris Spassky, former challenger David Bronstein, former candidate Mark Taimanov, Bill Lombardi, and a host of very, very strong players. And Keres is 59 years old at this point, and he's still winning tournaments against former world champions. Quite impressive. But as I mentioned, he passed away in 1970, later that year in 1975. So actually I have a final film clip for you from the Estonian government. They did a little in memoriam tribute to Keres, which I found quite good. It's a little longer, but it's worth it. So Keres, again, passed away, and his body arrived in Finland and then had to be delivered to Estonia via the sea. About 100,000 people attended his funeral service, which is almost a tenth of the population of the entire country. Christmas log, sorry.
Is he wearing a wig or something? I've never seen him with hair like that.
The 70s, they happened. And see, I don't know if that was his widow or his mom or something. So he was a national hero of Estonia, and after Estonia regained independence in 1991, they undertook several different measures to recognize him. They issued stamps with his likeness, they issued banknotes, currency with his likeness, and they even had a coin. You may know if you've traveled in Europe that the European Union has a standardized coin for 1 euro, 2 euros, etc. But they have tons of different designs from all their different member nations. And Estonia submitted a design with Paul Keres on it. And Eesti, I'm not sure how it's pronounced, but that's Estonia in Estonian. So that's part of his legacy to Estonia. He has a legacy outside of Estonia in his contributions to theory. For example, you may be familiar with the Keres attack in the Scheveningen, which starts with G4 in this Sicilian position, named after him, and White scores quite well in that attack, one of his notable contributions to theory that still bears his name. We've mentioned a little bit about books. He has published a number of books. Not all of them have been translated outside of Estonian. People who wanted to study his works often had to learn enough Estonian to actually read his books. Fisher, for example, read several of Paul Keres' books and taught himself enough Estonian, believe it or not, so that he could follow his annotations. A lot of his works have been translated into German, but not directly into English. So that's an area that we could still work on. I'm looking at you, Andy Soltis, or McFarland and Company. Could definitely use a good authoritative biography on Keres, like they've done with Botvinnik or Nimzowitsch or other players. And yes, there is still a memorial for him. You can sit down and play chess with him, and that's in Tallinn, in the capital of Estonia. So for this lecture, I use primarily the books that he wrote and that were translated, as I mentioned, by Harry Golombek. Incidentally, the third volume kind of ends abruptly. What happened is Keres just took all of his notes and basically gave them to Golombek and didn't even write any real introduction to some of his final games. And so Golombek had to do it from memory and from his own notes. So Golombek was not just a translator, he was also in a sense an editor and a co-contributor, at least to that third volume, and someone who, and you know, an English grandmaster who knew him quite well. I relied on that, and then I mentioned that I got some archival footage from the government of Estonia, and you can actually consult that and listen to the video with audio. And I had to kind of sort through film clips that were about like farm production and lots of other things and just pull out the bits about Keres. So that's all I have for you. Certainly welcome any questions that you have. I'll try, but again, information on Keres is scanter than I would like, unfortunately.
You know, just a comment, based on the turnout to his funeral, it seems like he was the most publicly popular chess player we've looked at.
You know, that could very well be true.
Maybe not the most well known, but the most well liked and looked up to. 100,000 people at a funeral, that's incredible.
It is. I can't think of any other. It's interesting to contrast it to someone like, say, Al Yakin, who was world champion for many, many years, but I think maybe 3 or 5 people came to his funeral. It's quite a contrast. Originally buried in Portugal and finally repatriated to France, but certainly, and part of that, I think, revolves around the fact that his death was unexpected. And he died at 59 of probably a heart attack. And so he was still very active. He was still very well known to current players and former players. So that's, I think, why you saw so many chess players at his funeral. Max Owo went to attended his funeral also. I think he was in one of the shots. But yeah, he may have been the most well-regarded and popular chess figures that we've covered.